Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you guys to tonight's council meeting. Mr. Bridge.
Fantastic. How are you, sir?
Good, thank you.
Awesome.
I'd like to call the regular scheduled council meeting for Monday, November 21st, 2016 at 7 p.m. Mr. Collier, when you're ready.
Mayor Bowder.
Here.
Mr. Reynolds.
Here.
Mr. Lindsay.
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Here.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Here.
And Mr. Craybaugh.
Here.
Six for present.
All right, we'll stand. We'll have tonight's invocation by Councilman Loman Lawton.
Please join me if you value it. Lord, thank you for allowing us to be together for this. Thank you for all that we do, the whole city, for the city of New Carlisle. We need to go forward. We're working on that. The council's working on it. Staff is working on that. Please help us with that, if you would, please. Thank you again for allowing us to have this meeting and for our city government. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. And time to do the pledge. We'll use this flag here.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We'll need actions on the minutes for regular council meeting of November 7th, 2016.
Mr.
Mayor. Mr. Lindsay.
Second.
Any comments or questions on the minutes, Council? Mr. Collier, when you're ready.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugh?
Yep.
Minutes passes 7-6-0.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to communications, Mr. Bridge, if you will, please.
Thank you, members of council, members of public and city staff. It is my great honor to introduce Clark County Sheriff-elect Deb Burchette and also Travis Russell.
If you would like for her to, I'm sure she would, sir.
That's the reason she's here, correct?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, just for Sheriff Lutz. Can you go up to the podium and tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, sure.
I'd just like to say that, I want to thank everyone for having me here this evening, and I've met most everyone, And we have a lot of new ideas in store for the sheriff's office, and we just can't wait to get started. We don't get to take office until the 2nd of January, but after the 2nd of January, we're going to hit that ground running. Guaranteed you on that. And like I say, we have many fresh and new ideas. Mr. Russell is actually my chief deputy, so you'll all be working with him also. But I just want to thank you for having me here tonight. And if you have any questions, any concerns, I will definitely have an open door policy for anyone that wants to call me or stop into my office. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, moving on to the city manager's report.
Mrs. Taylor's not here.
I don't see her. Yeah.
For the record, we did have another guest speaker, but that guest speaker is not here in the audience, so we will just move on with the agenda. Is that okay, Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. When you're ready for your report.
Okay, sure. So we're moving on to the city manager's report. I'd like to share with everyone what has been going on the administration side of things. First item up for action services under action report, and that is the Bell Manor. Friday, I got a phone call from Mark White at Bell Manor saying they're ready to move. He wants it done by the end of the year. So right now, I met with our city attorney this morning. We briefly discussed some things that we need to discuss. But in the meantime, we will be looking at contacting appropriate companies that we need to help us transfer that building. We're looking at your ITs, your AT&T. I still want to inquire with them to see if they have any environmental studies on record. or structural analysis that's on record. If they had it done in a reasonable amount of time and it's still a valid inspection, I would recommend us piggybacking off that. If they don't have an inspection on file, I would make a heavy recommendation that the city do its due diligence to make sure that there is no asbestos or no other thing that's kind of going to catch us after we take ownership of the building. I had a great conversation this morning with our chief, about potential locations of asbestos. So we've read over the agreement, the attorney and I, and we will take responsibility of that if we do inherit the building and we do discover any sort of environmental things that do need to be cleaned up. So I do think that the city does need to do its due diligence with making sure the building is good to go. I really think that we should obviously focus on city functionality first, getting it functioning as a city building for administration building so our citizens know where they have to go, and then follow it up with council chambers and looking for tenants. Tenants will probably become looking for tenants before we indulge in the council chambers. We haven't started getting quotes on council chambers yet, but I can assume that's going to be a pretty big ticket item. With that being said, the administration is going over our 2017 budget now. So when we go back and have more talks with that, me and Ms. Harris will allocate some additional money for that move. I do heavily believe that council should have a work session with your public to get their opinion on this. This is a big move for the city. I don't want another Madison Street School. I don't think anyone else up there wants another Madison Street School there too. I don't think this has the same background or makings as it to be a Madison Street School, but I still think our citizens should be involved in that input process. I would ask that too, I'm going to hit on this again at the bottom. I know there's some discussions about some shelter house upgrades and all that stuff. I would ask council to really think about those upgrades until after our Bell Manor move. I think our big focus for 2017 should be, among other things, such as the budget and making sure everything's running smoothly, but also too, we need to allocate, make sure that the city has enough funds and all the resources that we need to make this potential move very, very smooth. So yes, great news, they are ready to move forward. We'll be busting our butts up the city side of things to accommodate their request. But nothing will be done without having council approval. Okay. Some great news as we move on down. The next bullet point is our general obligation debt refinance. Me and Ms. Harris had met last week with some great people from Ross and Associates. We'll have the tentative schedule of events is actually attached to this. That's fluid, so it might change a little bit. Just bear with us. The bottom line is over the course of us repaying these our general obligation debts, we're going to save about $134,000. And that is a conservative estimate. And this morning, when Mr. Mayor was in my office, I let him know as to why that was a conservative estimate. And there are two things that surround that. We actually might get a little bit better deal. The first one surrounds our audit that we're getting done by the state right now. If there's indicators that it's improving, which there is no doubt it will, that might play into us getting essentially a lower interest rate. A couple of weeks ago, I sent out an email to council members regarding the city's S&P ratings, which is our bond rating. We are a B plus, triple B, B plus. Although we didn't go up in our triple B plus rating, we increased inside of the rankings they have within the BB plus. For example, we were at adequate before, but now we're up to an improving status. So, but in that S&P, it blatantly had said that new management is in place in the city, which we're making changes to get our budget to where it needs to be and our rating to where it needs to be. So hats off to our finance director, Ms. Colleen Harris. The work that you have seen that since I've taken over city manager and working with Ms. Harris, we're seeing that positive comeback in our bond rating, which is a great, great thing. So very excited about that. I really hope these numbers are a little bit more, but we'll have to see after it all plays out what exactly we're going to get. But hopefully we're going to at least shoot for $134,000 savings, and that's big for the city, so awesome for that. That's all I have until I get to informational items, so I would like to pass it on to our finance director, Ms. Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Mayor, council, and members of the public. I'm going to go over the October finance report. So for the month of October, our revenue that we collected is $385,965.61. For October, our total expenditures was $389,080.62. That brings our year-to-date total revenue collected at $5,152,185.84. And our year-to-date expenditures is $4,032,680.95. General fund income tax collected for the month of October was $86,101.43. We have a year-to-date total for the general fund income tax at $966,835.04. And then with the 0.5% police income tax levy, we collected for the month of October $43,050.72. And that brings a year-to-date total at $474,912.56. And I have the other income and expenditures broken down and our list of checks. If there's any questions, I can entertain.
Council, any questions or comments from the service? Mr. McLaughlin?
I have one. Well, I actually have two. Ready Electric Company talked about replaced damaged streetlights. We are collecting money from people that have damaged them. I would take it from auto insurance or whatever to help pay that.
Absolutely.
Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
We've paid out $12,940. Is that a couple lights? Is that what we're looking at?
Yes. There was two, the one at Lee's and the one that was at Studebaker's. It was a hit and run. That one was taken care of by our insurance. And then the other street light at Lee's, I just went through the claim process with Progressive, and they received the full amount of our repair bill. And with the city garage damage that we had, we also did receive our $500 deductible back from our insurance due to the person who hit it, their insurance paying us our insurance back.
So a damaged light is, what would you say, around $7,000, $8,000?
$5,660.
Total. That's put up everything?
Except for the foundation. As long as the foundation is not damaged. That's the pole, rewiring it in the globe.
Just to let everyone know that. Don't hit one. It'll cost you money. One other question I have for you. Just to let everybody know, the backhoe loan, there's three different departments that help pay that. It's an annual budget. If you've looked at that, I don't know if council, I'm sure you have. Just to let everyone know, three different departments actually use that and help pay for it. So that's why it's broken down as it is. That's it for me.
Thank you, sir. Council, any other questions? Thank you, Ms. Harris. Appreciate that. Mr. Bridge?
Yep. And moving on with our city manager's report, our service director, Mr. Kitko.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council, members of the public. Just a couple items to update. Leaf pickup, we are currently on schedule. We have been trying to hit certain sections ahead of schedule with the dry leaves. We have been getting calls that they see us come down the street and then be a week early or whatever. We will come back down in our designated week anyway. We're just trying to get the leaves while we can. So even if you didn't get them raked out, we'll just put them out there for your scheduled week and we'll still pick them up. Tree work is ongoing. We just had four trees taken down. Actually five, the one out here in Smith Park too. We still have more in the parks, but that work is still ongoing and we'll get to all the damaged trees that we have in our parks. Also, we are currently working on budgeting for projects in 2017, street projects and different ones in our utilities. So that is all I have right now. I can entertain any questions in the service departments.
Council. Mr. Lindsay.
On the trees, Mr. Kitko, how many trees in Willow Wick Park will be removed?
I think we have two left to go in Willow Wick. We removed this summer three, and I think we have two left to go.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Kitko, not that we'll need it. I know we've got salt, but are there snow piles or anything ready to go for the winter?
We have the salt spreader on one truck already, but yes, everything is pretty much ready to go, and yes, we do. Salt barn is full.
Right. Thank you.
Good job.
Okay, and moving on with the city manager's report, our fire discussion with our fire chief, Chief Trusty. New mayor, council members, and the city public. First off, apologize for my typo. It should say month of October instead of month of September. The Carlisle Fire Division responded to 74 EMS calls in the city, 13 EMS calls in Elizabeth Township. The division responded to three fire-related calls in the city, zero in Elizabeth Township. We had three EMS calls answered by mutual aid, either by Pike Township or Bethel Park, through the RMATIC being already on a response. We answered two mutual aid calls, either to Bethel Park or to Pike Township. Medic 52A responded to two medic runs, and we needed to get our second run medic out the door twice in that month. On the EMS side, Assistant Chief Geiserman now taught two CPR classes for 10 people, again, at no cost to them. She does all those free. We completed the pump tests for engine 52 and truck 52, which both passed. Annual test that has to be done on the apparatus. In between our the Heritage Flight Festival, what we did there, this for our booth, and with the generous donation from the festival of the other side of the 50-50 drawing, and a couple other things we've done in the past month, we were able to raise over $3,000 towards our Lucas Tool Fund, which brings us right at about $6,200 right now, about halfway there. We still have smoke detectors in the station that we can, for the citizens, and we're more than happy to come out and install those for the public. We'd rather us install it than just handing them out. I really know we're doing that at one of the places. Other than that, it's been a pretty slow month. Thank you.
Mr. Craybacher.
The other day, I think about a week ago, on Bayberry, there was a drug overdose. The person didn't make it. How often do you still go?
Drug overdoses?
Yeah.
We probably average 2 to 3 a week.
Can you expand on that a little bit?
It's the heroin. We also have a couple that have been overdoses on prescription medications. And we've had one this past week that was a suicide attempt by a prescription meds. But the majority of our overdoses are heroin.
I know that a lot of it starts with prescription drugs, mm-hmm. and it kind of progresses from there. When they take them off the prescription drugs, then they go on to the heroin. You can get them on the street a lot easier, you know. So, I hate to think of, you know, that it's really bad here, but I know it is bad. You know, and you know, I'm just trying to get people to understand, you know, how severe, you know, it is. Really.
It's bad in New Carlisle, just like it's bad in any other township or city. As Sergeant Contessa is, it's so common and it's so easy for people to get and to use. Yeah, some of it does come from the fact to be on prescription meds first. A lot of it also too is just drug users, or you know, it's the drug of the choice right now because it is so easy. And like I said before, the biggest thing we need right now is education. You know, educating the public, educating them when they're young, and in school before they get to that point. But you know, and we're running a lot of repeat offenders. You know, we've picked up two or three different people that we pick up three or four times over this. And we bring them back, and then they don't want to go to the hospital because we bring them back. Or if they do go to the hospital, before our medic crew is done with their report and back at the station, they're back in the street.
Can you tell me, do you know what is the youngest person that you have brought back?
We brought back 18-year-old, 19-year-olds, brought back 17-year-olds.
I'm hearing lower than that.
They're out there, and we do. I mean, on occasions, we've hit maybe a 16-year-old or 15-year-old. The majority of ours are anywhere from 20 to 25 range. Somewhere around there.
Maybe just a little.
Yeah. I know it's bad all over the United States. There was a couple documentaries that have been on the TV this weekend, you know, on drug overdose, and they followed this one guy from Pittsburgh. They're even the same doctors are even shooting up before they even doing surgeries, you know, so.
No, and we're fortunate in the city right now that we have, with the fire division, of course, and the medics and the medic crews,
We're also very fortunate that the deputies are now carrying the Narcan also, and very well trained in how to use it and are willing to use it. Our deputies have Narcan people several times, and following the protocol that needs to be done. When we get there, they can tell us, okay, I Narcan you by giving this dose and this dose. And because we have to document how many doses we give them, we're out of them. The problem being, before, 6 months ago, if we ran an OD, we could Narcan, give them one dose of Narcan, we would usually bring them back. Right now, it's averaging anywhere from 4 to 6 to 8 doses of Narcan before we get them back.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. The more Narcan to use, you know, the more resistance that they have.
Well, it's not only that, it's also what they're cutting the heroin with. They're cutting it with fentanyl.
And they're cutting it with something else. I think, isn't fentanyl kind of going out of the way and they're doing it stronger with something else?
It is, and then one of the parts of the fentanyl that they're using now is a elephant tranquilizer.
Chief, could you just tell everybody what the Lucas tool is used for again, please? And my other part of that is, I'm sorry?
Total cost.
Well, in total cost for it. The other thing is, fire department would definitely recognize if we have businesses that would like to have a write-off for the end of the year to help donate towards this.
Oh, definitely.
Again, we're on film here, if any of you see that. And
definitely.
Maybe some of the other banks and so
we
forth
put
in the area.
On the side of the net and donate by. I don't have a problem with that.
If you could answer that.
The Lucas tool is an automatic CPR device that's put on the patient, put down under their chest, and it does perfect CPR continuously for the medics. It puts an extra person on the medic. It can be put on the patient, and the patient can be moved from wherever they're at, onto the gurney, into the medic, even going up and down stairs, and it stays in place on the patient. It does perfect CPR for us. And one, like I said, it takes away from having, because you, as a human, you're going to do good CPR for about 3 minutes, and you're going to be tired out. And so we're constantly swapping EMTs or firefighters out doing CPR. Plus also too, going to the hospital en route, that keeps a medic or a firefighter from having to stand up in the back of the medic, which is unsafe, doing CPR all the way to the hospital. And our closest hospital for a cardiac is either Springfield or Grandview. So you're still looking at a 20 to 25 minute ride with someone trying to stand up and do CPR. So it does perfect CPR for us. It's a fantastic tool. The cost for one right now is right in between $13,000 and $14,000 for one tool. And then after 1 year of having the tool, we would procure another $4,000 maintenance program for that tool for 4 years.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McLaughlin. Chief, also, could you do me a favor? Coming into the wintertime, and a lot of people are turning on their furnaces and gas fireplaces for the first time, could you go over just some basic carbon monoxide safety tips and detectors and
biggest
things?
Biggest thing I can say is have your furnaces, if it's a gas furnace of any type, have it serviced. Have it serviced by a licensed professional, have them clean it, have them service it, check it. The CO detectors are just as important as a smoke detector. Having them in the house, if your CO detector goes off, get out of the house. Everybody get out of the house. Don't even call us beforehand. Get everybody out of the house. Call us from a neighbor. Call us from your cell phone. Let us come in. We have detectors that we can use. Our crews will mask up, go in, check the house for the levels, make sure that it's a lot of times it's a faulty detector. But if there is a leak, if there is levels, our detector will be able to detect the odor and detect the levels. 2 years ago, we lost 3 children in Tip City to it,
mm-hmm.
on one call. And at that time, the grandmother was transported the night before with flu-like symptoms, which carbon monoxide poisoning does just that. It gives you flu-like symptoms. And if they would have known about the night before, it could have saved those 3 kids' lives.
Yeah.
That's the reason with our medics right now, I'm getting ready to repurchase ours because they're a throwaway item. It's called a rattler that goes on our first bin bags that when they go in the home, if it detects a high level of a CO, it automatically goes off. And that way it'll tell our crews that there's a danger in the home.
Great. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Council, any questions? Thank you, Chief. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Chief Chesty. And moving on with our city manager report, our police discussion with Sergeant Underwood.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mayor, Council, citizens. On November 19, 2016, Deputy Michael Lyons resigned from the Clark County Sheriff's Office so she and her husband could move out of state to be with their families. And we all want to wish Miecho and her family the best and happy holidays to them. She's done a good job when she's been up here. She's worked a late shift and she's going to be missed. She was one of the girls, no doubt. Deputy Miecho Lyons will be replaced by Deputy Bruce Johnson, who is currently assigned to the jail division. Deputy Johnson will go through a short training period with new crowd deputies before starting his shift. And tonight, Bruce, will stand up, is Bruce Johnson. He's going to be your new person in the evening. And I want to hope you get to know him, stop and ask him questions. And he has worked up here before. It's been a while, what, a couple of years? About three on a 45-day assignment. So glad to have him aboard, and we'll get him squared away this week.
Welcome back.
And then from all the Clark County Sheriff's Office, we want to wish everyone a happy Thanksgiving. And especially, we want to say thank you for all your support. It does make a difference. We are here. We're in public safety. So again, thank you. Now, as the monthly report, my duties have been split up here in the last couple of months, and it's not exactly what I like, but this is kind of in the raw. If you look at the, it says CCSO stat sheet, and I didn't change the date at the top. I have November, see that, it's a mistake. Mm-hmm. there was a little article about me being able to forecast the future. So if it's easy, the deputy stats are right there. If you need to know who they are, I'd be more than happy to tell you after the meeting. But if you look at where the T's at, about the seventh, eighth column over, those are the totals of the calls added up that we have been to. And let's see, verbal domestics is up, and that's 10. That's quite a bit for up here. Mm-hmm. If you remember, we run in the summertime, 2, 3, 4 is a high number, mm-hmm. but we're already into the winter months and we have 10. We have had some crashes in New Carlisle. I don't know if the state handling any. I know that was a question a couple months ago. Either your New Carlisle deputies are, or the Clark County Sheriff's deputies are handling them. Of course, you might see them in here, in and out here. Throughout the day or the evening. So if there's any questions on those, if you want to go over them, I'd be more than happy to answer. And the following page is going to be part of our new CAD system. Now, and I'm sure I'll have some help here with our chief deputy and our sheriff-elect to compile something that you want. But if you look down through here, if you see the column that says total, pay attention to that column. We don't know what unfounded actual by arrest and exceptionally is right now. So we're just getting into this, and I wanted to bring it here to you early so you'll see we're going to be able to break it down just like the first one, unruly juvenile offenses. We had two. If you want to get on your computer and look up Ohio Revised Code or ORC, that is the section number, 2115.022. You can tell exactly what it says. But I do have to caution you, each word is important when you get in the ORC. And we had two assaults. An assault knowingly had harm on the victim, aggravated menacing, and I'm not going to read the whole list, it goes on. So this is something that we're getting that is new, along with we're still going to do the end of our notebooks and things. We have the capability in our car now, and we're just getting started on it. I believe it's going to be implemented the 1st of December, where you're not going to hear us on the radio as much. Sometimes it's even dangerous, there's so much radio traffic. All the time, we'll have somebody making a stop and someone else trying to make a traffic stop or out on a burglar or whatever. And just those short few seconds, things happen. So we'll be able to get on the computers in the cars, generate reports. The mapping system is awesome. You, as a supervisor, you'll see every call on your computer screen that comes in. And dispatch will list them in priorities. It's pretty darn neat, actually. And as a supervisor, I can sit down in the car and I can tell the priority calls, the medic calls versus the police calls. You know, if we're close, we can go assist. It's really a great tool. This came out in the late 90s. We're a little bit behind, or it's time to catch up. So with that, that's a good positive for us. What I need to do is sit down with the city manager and we'll decide what kind of staff that you actually want. I can tell you, we had 53 reports for the city of New Carlisle, and normally I break that down into deputies, but I wasn't going to give you a number that was made up. I couldn't tell this month. And that might even be more difficult next month until they separate them in the CAD system where right now, it's just how many reports in New Carlisle. Does it generate the deputies of New Carlisle, how many reports they have taken? Does that make sense to you? So out of that 53, I can't tell you how many was taken by New Carlisle deputies or a deputy on the road in Clark County. So with that, that's actually my presentation tonight. I'd be happy to entertain any questions if you have any, and we'll go from there.
Mr. Lauer.
I have one. I have two, actually. But this one kind of jumped out at me, and
okay.
Not trying to be funny about it, but what is theft without consent? Is there theft with consent? I've never seen this before.
Yeah, it's just the way the law is worded. You can have theft by deception.
Okay.
Or consent. Let's say I go out to my business every day, and I throw my trash in your dumpster.
Okay.
That's theft by deception.
Okay.
Okay. Or I try to trick you in some way to get some money out of you. So it's just the way it's worded. It does get complicated.
Okay. Thank you. Next one may be to the young lady sitting beside me. And I'll just make a statement. For a long time, Mr. Underwood has been in New Carlisle. He's been our go-between to the sheriff. Did a whole lot of paperwork, things that he was never paid for. I may get taken on the way home for this one, I don't know, but he was never appreciated. I can tell you that. And he was treated pretty damn bad. I'm sorry. Are you going to change that?
Absolutely.
Are you going to keep him here a few more hours?
We've already discussed a little bit about that.
Okay, I hope you discuss it a whole lot more, because
Ralph
is very valuable to this community. He's done a lot of good hard work and done a lot of good things. And, as I said, he was not appreciated in the past. Couldn't do the job that he was assigned to do.
Right.
Okay? Thank you. And I'm going to hold you to your word.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay? Thank you.
Council. Mr. Lindsay.
I just want to follow up with what Mr. Lauer said. The sergeant has not been appreciated by some in the county. I think everybody up here in the city staff thinks he's pretty efficient in his job, and I for one would like to see him more in the town than what he has been lately and actually do what his original job assignment was up here. That's all I've been saying.
Thank you, sir.
Sergeant Underwood, just to kind of ask you another question. With us rolling into Christmas and busy season of holidays, what kind of, were you going to expect a spike in police dispatches and some crime, I'm assuming? Does it typically spike this time of year for us?
It'll be some, but what we'll pick up is domestic calls. Something happened today that opened my eyes, and I just couldn't believe it. Our homeless situation in the county is a lot more than what you think. Mm-hmm. I worked with a young lady today. I was able to get her housing up until December 1st. If not, she was going on the street tonight. No money, no food, all her personal belongings, she would have had to drug with her. And we have a few up here also. Mm-hmm. And there's no doubt about it. If they will come to us or we can find them, we will do what we can to help. But because of our current drug situation, people are running out of funds to help other people. Mm-hmm. That's how bad it really is. And if you have the generosity in your heart to donate a few dollars here and there, please, by all means, do. We really have people out there that can use it.
Thanks, sir. Mr. Bridge.
We're at Student Bakers about a month ago. Mm-hmm. We had a lady approach us about the young man who was kicked out of his house. Do you recall that conversation?
I recall that call. I was here. Yes.
As was that remedied? Did we find that young man?
That young man was placed in a home up north of here. We actually had a Deputy Alan Cox was with us on that. Let me start off. Here's what happened real fast. We had a mother and son. Son's 18 years old that could not get along. There was a conflict just in personality. Mom had it and wanted him out. And by law, she's allowed to do that. Just because you live there doesn't mean that it's free all the time, even if you're a family member. If you pay some of the bills, that gives us something to work with. You may have the right to be there. But if you have no mail coming in, you help financially, you don't help financially, she can have you removed. And that's what happened. That's unfortunate. Sometimes we have a job we have to do and we don't like it. So we escorted the young man out of his house. Deputy Cruz was able to make a few phone calls. We got a hold of a girlfriend, and she had like a two-hour drive to come and pick him up. But he did have a place to stay, and at the end, Mom gave him his cat, and he was happy, and we haven't heard from him. So, but it was a full-blown domestic. Mm-hmm. She wanted him out, and by law, we had to have him removed.
18-year-old cat always knows everything.
Thanks, Sergeant.
I'm just going to tag on to you a little bit. Second Harvest comes up here now. They have three different locations that come up here during the month. You know, and they give out free food. You know, no questions, don't have to worry about income, don't have to worry about anything. And since I've been involved with them, one thing that's been amazing to me, we have been able to service over 300-some people at one sitting, at a location.
That's big.
That's big. And you know, people, the moms or the dads or would come, you know, and we would count whoever is in the household. If it's 8 people in the household, if it's 10 people in the household, whatever. So, but the mobile food bank has been up here, and they're looking for another spot, too. And hopefully they're going to be in Donaldsville, real shortly. So being as small as Donaldsville is, talking about the homeless population, somehow they're kind of gravitating down 40. So, I was amazed at all the people that they do service. And they have a lot of facilities out there.
What's the service is needed? We have people out here tonight. It's cold. We complain about turning our heat up. And they're living someplace that we can't find.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, cars. Cars are big, but if you're ever in town at Veterans Park or you know where the Plum Street Bridge is at in there, a few years ago I was working a detail there, and the guy said, "Hey, Sarge, come over here. You're not going to believe this. There must have been 20 or more people living under that bridge."
Yeah, that's right.
And it's kind of scary when you stop and think about it. But we do have a need for those type of people to help them. I almost called today, the food bank up here. That's how desperate I was getting. Well, finally got a hold of mental health, and they were able to wave their magic wand and work a miracle, actually. Mm-hmm. So mental health was gracious. Bailed this lady out. which I don't think she'd have made it, to be honest with you.
Council, any other questions, comments? Thank you, Sergeant. Appreciate the report.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sergeant Underwood. And moving on with the city manager's report, just got a few items under information I'd like to share. Waste management, the brochures have been mailed out, so hopefully you guys have those in your possession. It is very important that you tear off that postcard and either mail it back to them and choose a service level or pick up the phone and give them a call. If you do not do that, they'll just give you the big cart and you'll pay for that. You can always call after you get that big one and switch it out. But if they don't hear from you, they will just issue the standard 96 gallons. So it's very important that you follow the instructions on that brochure or give them a call. If you are age 65 or older, you will need to copy your driver's license and probably send that in to them. If any senior citizen doesn't have access to a computer, please come see us at the city building. We would love to help you out with that. But again, very important that you read over that brochure and then to send back. This morning, I did send stuff out to our city website, so there's all a whole plethora of information now listed on the city website. Please take a minute to review that as well. It's a letter to the residents that I wrote last night. It goes on to have a pricing chart on there, but I also broke out each level of service and said what you're going to get with that particular service level size. You're going to get the same service no matter if you have the 35, 64, or 96. You're just going to pay a different price to do this. So again, waste management brochures have been mailed. Please don't disregard them. Please take action. Send them back to waste management or give them a call directly. Shelter house updates. I kind of hit on this when I was going over the Bell Manor building donation. We're still waiting on a second quote for that for the build out. Please consider waiting on massive upgrades to the shelter house until after the Bell Manor move. One more thing that I'd like to discuss is information under informational items. Traffic counts. TCC will be doing traffic counts at our main intersections, and that's State Route 235 and Lake Avenue, that's Speedway, and also State Route 235 and 571. And there'll be traffic count cameras installed. I'm assuming they're above.
Yeah, they're MyoVision
cameras. MyoVision cameras. So if you see any kind of apparatus up on the current infrastructure looking down, it's traffic counts. They will be done on Wednesday, November 30th. However, the install will be the day before, and the taking them down will be the day after. There is a reason why we're doing this. I will have some very exciting news in the coming weeks to share with council. Very similar to how I worked on getting the playground equipment. This is something that one of my very first jobs acts as being a city manager. I was kind of working with the appropriate agencies to get this for the city. I think it's going to be a bonus. All information will be shared with council and the citizens when the time comes, but this is the first step to do that. But I'm very excited to share the big announcement when we have the appropriate time to do so.
Is that what you call a teaser? A
little teaser, yeah.
Yeah.
I tease with the playground equipment. Look how great that turned out. You know? So that's all I have for the city manager's report. I'd be happy to entertain any questions.
Mr. Bridge, I just wanted to touch on one thing. I know you've talked about it a few times. We keep talking about Bell Manor. I just want to stress to everyone that that's not a done deal. That will still have to get voted on. So I don't want anybody thinking that it is going to be ours for sure. That'll go to council, and council will vote on whether or not we take that building or not. I just want to make sure everyone knows that, because that's a big step for us.
It is, and it's a big move for the city. So take it day by day and do everything correctly, and trust that everything's come back to the way we need it to come back, and those in charge of making decisions make the best decision possible for the city. But you can bet that the administration side of things will definitely do things the way it needs to be done. We'll pass everything along to these six, hopefully seven, fine folks by the time that rolls around, and they can decide if it's the best move for the city or not.
Thank you. Mr. Lauer?
Shelter House.
Yes.
Okay. Just have to think of something, going to throw it at you and see what happens.
Sure.
How much money? What are we talking? We've got $5,000 from the county commissioners. Is that correct?
We will have. We were supposed to get $5,000 for the project.
Okay.
For the project. That was in 16. So if we wait to 17, not sure if we're still going to get it or not. Because they now have a new new county
commissioner. So that's not guaranteed?
I'm not saying it's not guaranteed. It's not guaranteed for 17. It's guaranteed for 16.
Okay. Would that be absolutely, if we got that from them, would that be $5,000 that was earmarked that says you have to spend it on the shelter house?
probably spend however we choose. I really think it's $5,000 off for our police services if you really want to get
$5,000 more?
For our police services, they did the same thing in 15 as well.
Okay. But it is $5,000 in check or cash that we're going to get? It's mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I got something to say about it.
What's that?
Shelter House is here. It's rented almost every day of the year, is it not? Could be rented more, could be charged more, but I personally think that saving a person's life is a whole lot more important than showing up with the fire department. That's my take on it.
Well,
for the Lucas earmark tool. For the Lucas tool.
Sure.
Now, if that idea doesn't work and that can't be done, I think at our next meeting, which is the 28th, that we put them on the spot and tell them we need about $8,000 for our Lucas tool. See what they can do for us. They
sure.
Spend a lot of money in Springfield. We don't get a whole lot over here. So, and I mean, that's a known fact. It's, I don't care.
I'll be honest with you. I think that's a better use of $5,000 than putting it into the shelter house.
I do too. That saves lives.
So if council would like
to. And that would just about get you there if you had $5,000, would it not, Steve?
When I get back in the office on the 28th, I will be more than happy to
write a letter. I mean, you need to ask these gentlemen over here, but that's my take on it. That saves lives.
Allocate that money.
That saves lives. And that's my take. That's all I got.
Do you need a motion to approve that?
No.
Well, I have one council member directing me to do that. I don't know what the other 6-5 thing.
I didn't direct you. I'm asking.
Well, I agree with you.
Mr. Lindsay?
I, too, have a question on the shelter house.
Mm-hmm.
The talking to her second quote for a build-out. What kind of build-out are you talking about? Are you talking about the kitchenette that we discussed a year ago? First part of this year?
My original plan was to do a kitchenette in the side.
Yes.
Okay, then people had the idea to do an actual build out on the outside of the shelter house. So you don't use any essentially inside square area.
Okay. I think the kitchenette in a corner, whatever corner you choose to put it in,
mm-hmm.
is only going to take up the width of a countertop. And the cabinet
mm-hmm.
versus spending thousands of dollars to knock a hole in a wall someplace, run plumbing and all that stuff, and put a kitchen in. I don't think we need a kitchen. That's just my opinion. The $5,000 that was mentioned here, I think I agree with Mr. Lowry. It should go to the fire department. If we can do that, again, it's just a suggestion that. To get that Lucas tool. I think that's much more important than building a kitchenette here. And if I'm not mistaken, did we not earmark in the budget something like $8,000 to $10,000 to put a kitchenette in here mm-hmm. for this year?
I think it was in our CIP
yeah.
for
yes.
16.
So if it's already been budgeted and stuff, why don't we go ahead and just put the kitchenette in? And I don't know who up here came up with the idea or who gave you the idea to build whatever they were wanting to build,
mm-hmm.
but I think that's a complete waste of money.
I think it just stemmed from what would it cost to do this opposed to do that. I don't think anybody was saying, this is what we're going to do. Is
right.
We're going to do the inside. What would it cost to do the outside as well?
If you're going to build a building, just to build a building has got to be 20-some grand, I'd say. And then you got to look at electrical, plumbing, your sewer lines, and you look at another at least $10,000 to $15,000 for that. Then you have to buy the cabinets and the appliances, and I mean, it just you're looking at $50,000 time you're done. I just don't think that's a good expenditure, in my opinion.
I agree with you.
I'm just one voice up here. I don't know what the others are thinking.
Sure.
But as far as the $5,000 that we may be getting from the county, I agree with Mr. Lowry, it should go to the fire department to help purchase that Lucas tool. Because that will have a lot more benefit to the city than any kitchen or kitchenette mm-hmm. or anything we can do for the shelter house.
Okay. Sure.
Council, any other questions?
Mr. Reynolds.
I'll make it short and sweet. Yes, I agree with Rick. I think that we should use that money to purchase the Lucas tool if possible.
I'll write the letter Monday when okay. I get back from Thanksgiving break. And I agree with everyone there. I think it's best use of $5,000.
We don't need a motion or anything for that.
I think it falls into day-to-day operations.
Okay.
Not allocate money. So I like that everybody share their opinions, but and I agree with everybody. I think it's the best use of the $5,000 that we could possibly do with that gift.
I don't know how you make a motion and vote on something when you don't have the money.
You don't have the money.
We wish we get the money.
Put a higher of you, higher of us on the card. You owe us.
Mr. Lindsay?
I mean, you had three council members speak on this. I'd like to hear what the other three had to say if they so choose to make a comment on this. You know, maybe they have another project they'd rather just go to, like, you know, $5,000 towards another police cruiser. I mean, I don't know. Might buy a couple of tires.
No, I think, I mean, $5,000 isn't a whole lot of money when you look at it, but considering what it could finish off paying for them, is, yeah, I mean, that's kind of a no-brainer there, really, I think, my opinion.
I agree with you.
I don't know who had the idea of putting a new, you know, extending the building out, because I thought that, you know, when you said a kitchenette, I thought it was going back up. You always point it to the corner, and that's where I thought it was going to be. Just like a little kitchenette. I'd like to see the floor done, if anything, you know, in there. That's what I would like to see. But however, you know, the $5,000, you know, Tory Lucas tool would be very beneficial to more citizens.
Sure. I agree with you on that. I just really think council should not be doing any repairs until we get this, I mean, renovations done to the shelter house until we get Bell Manor done.
I agree.
That's just bottom line. No floor, no kitchenette, no build out until we get over the Bell Manor.
Yeah.
And then we find out what's going on there, and then we can invest. Mr. Lowry, Mr. Rick Lowry, down the right on head. We have no problem renting this place out. None. We still turn people away. So,
every day.
You know, I think that at some point in time, yes, we should put a little money back into this place, but I think we've got more important things on our agenda than expanding or putting a kitchenette inside the shelter house. I think that's very responsible use of taxpayer money to just put off on hold and focus on Bell Manor.
Mr. Crable.
You keep bringing up Bell Manor, so let's talk about Bell Manor just a little bit. I know the central building, but there's also some outbuildings that comes along with that, right? Is it two houses, three houses?
There's actually three additional buildings coming with that. There's two private residents, one's being rented out, and then the other is actually they're using as storage.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what I needed to know.
Yeah.
You might get a phone call.
What?
You'll get a phone call if somebody was interested in.
Sure.
In the storage one.
And the what?
The one that that's being used for storage. The other two are already rented out.
Well, the other one, no, they have a private residence that's currently rented out. They have a private residence that's not rented out, they're using as storage. But then they have, like, a white cinder block building next to the maintenance shed that is they're using as storage as well, or maintenance or something like that.
Nobody else with the maintenance shed.
Yeah, so I don't know what condition the private residence they're using for storage is. But, you know, once we get into that, it's going to happen pretty quick. I'll have my, what I think should be done, recommendation to council when it comes to terms of everything and composite. It's a very big move, but we'll do it correctly.
Any other questions for Mr. Bridge, Council? Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Appreciate the report.
Mayor.
Chief.
Thank you.
Well,
the division already knows that we have the city's backing and we have the city's support, not only from the council and mayor, but also from the citizens this year. But that, I mean, to be able to go out and tell whether we can do it or not, but to tell the division, this is how the city feels about us, that is such a morale boost and makes everyone's job so much easier. And I thank you very much.
Thank you. Whose idea was that? Hats off to you. Fantastic. Good idea.
Just common sense.
Oh. I got a lot of common sense that crossed my mind. I was focused on something else. So.
All right, moving on from the city manager's report, move to comments from the members of the public. So if anyone, Mr. Cobb, Mr. Grill. Huh?
Shall I move a little bit back to the box?
Ron Cobb, 202 Villa Drive. You know, all I hear, want to put a kitchen in here, we want to do the floors, we want to do Bell Manor. We're still kicking the can down the road we forgot about over here on Madison Street, the school. Instead of throwing money elsewhere, let's get the school tore down. You know, you want to spend money here. You want to spend money there. But we're forgetting about this over here. You know, that's all I heard. I want to put a vanity in or the kitchenette in here. You've talked about wanting to redo the floors, but we're still looking at the eyesore over here. You've got Bell Manor coming up that you want to dump $34,000 in. That's $34,000 to be spent over here to get rid of the Madison Street School.
Right. I don't think anybody's forgotten about it, Ron. I mean, you know, I think we just, we try to look at things at what, you know, in priority. You know, I'm not even sure if, you know, my personal opinion, I'm not sure if I'm sold on the whole Bell Manor idea, but that's, you know, that's a different story. But
yeah, but your priority's right over on Madison Street. That needs to come down.
Mr. Owens.
I know we had the opportunity to take it down this year, but we passed for roads. Now my question is, do we know if that's coming up this year again? Mr. Bridge, do we know?
You've missed the boat on that.
For how many years do we know?
That amount of money in 1 year. And I was pretty explicit with council when I gave you that information. Yeah. It's not going to come around to that extent. I would probably, we're not going to be awarded that until 3 years and another probably 3 years after that. Council missed the boat. I'm not trying to rehash anything, but that was the time to do it. But it's going to be some time for them, for that particular form of funding, which was block grant.
Yeah.
From the land bank. It's going to take some time for the county to give us that much in 1 year.
All right. The last, I know the last estimate to take the school down was from the mid to late 90s, wasn't it?
No, actually, I think it was closer to like 06 or
08.
Was it?
It was 08.
Yeah. And I think the low one was maybe at 180, and I think there's a high one for 220, but each one had the stipulation that says if there's additional environmental asbestos, you're going to pay to get it down, pay to remove it. So I don't think those quotes were valid then, and I know it's really not valid now because it's just been 10 years. So, yeah.
I have one fast follow up. I know that David Hare was the one who worked on that to get us that block grant funding. Right. Mr. McLaughlin, when you start January 2nd, 3rd, or 4th, if you want to start looking into that for us, that'd be fantastic.
We're going to start collecting dynamite.
I totally agree with that.
We had some on Lake Avenue. I think they threw it away.
Anything else, Mr. Cobb? That's something you need to concentrate on over here. Yeah. This is ridiculous. It's getting ridiculous. You got an old school that's deteriorating, but we want to spend money elsewhere and throw it away. And before you consider Bell Manor, you need to concentrate over here.
Mr. Bridge.
I like what you're having to say, Mr. Cobb. You come into it with an open mind, and I agree with you. I think that is the elephant in the room that everybody just kind of looks the other way with. Right now we pay about $1,800, $1,900 a month for rent at the city building because we do not own our city building. Okay, so we're going to be taking that expense off of the city's budget. Once we get Bell Manor, if it comes through, we'll also get additional income through the private house. So I understand your concern. And I don't know how to say this, but the Bell Manor situation is still unknown and it's still a risk. But we are going to be inherited something that does not have any sort of monthly fee or monthly rent. So hopefully that can alleviate some of the city expenses. But it's on my back burner for the school. It's just a matter of finding money that the city has to match. Because any kind of grant opportunity that I go after now is not going to be as easy as the block grants. We're going to have to put up a lot more, probably 50% match, to get any kind of grants with that. So, I'm not saying it's going to happen in 17, but I do intend on aggressively going after some grants to get that torn down. But grants aren't the same landscape as they were 10, 15 years ago. You know, that is essentially a commercial structure. If that was zoned a residential, it'd be a lot easier to get funding to tear that down. But since it's a commercial establishment, there's a lot more stipulation. It's kind of harder to get grants to alleviate blighted situations that are commercially zoned. I mean, yeah. A commercial use, I should say.
But yes, you were paying rent here, but you had a city building down here that's bigger than what you got there that the city owned, but you decided, well, not you. Mm-hmm. The previous council decided to sell it and move down here and pay $1,800, $1,900 a month on a smaller building, which was stupid in the first place. I mean, you had a proper building down there, which was bigger than what you had down here.
Do you know why they sold? I don't want to get into a 20-minute conversation. I wasn't here, but the old building wasn't ADA compliant to where they were forcing them to do massive upgrades, where it's cheaper for them just to get rid of the building?
Need repair.
Yeah, the only thing that was said on the old building, it was going to be up need upgrade, it was going to cost X number of dollars.
ADA compliant, sure. Okay.
But you sold the building, you moved into one, you're paying $1,800 a month rent now, which is smaller than what you had there. You got to use the shelter house as your council chambers. You know, the buck's got to stop somewhere, people.
Thank you, Mr. Cobb. Nancy?
Nancy, your favorite disclaimer walking up to the podium.
Yeah. I like that.
Nancy Labanovich, 505 Pease Avenue, New Carlisle. I've got a couple statements just to say on narco. Number one, I think it's making the idea of taking that drug more desirable because you know you got a way out, which is what they did with the birth control pills. And I think we ought to make a law that if you have to use narco three times, that's it. You don't get it anymore. You want to try it again? Die. On the homeless, you have a lot of mental health people out there homeless. Half of it because our dear governor decided he wasn't going to give us any tax money to keep the big whole places open like Spring Hill. They closed that down and threw them out in the street. Springview. I never get it right. So that one ticks me off completely because I have a daughter that if it wasn't for me, she'd be out on the street too. And those people are the ones that really get taken advantage of because they get subsidies from the government. And once they get these kids to trust them, which isn't hard, then they take that money and they blow it on drugs, etc. And once we get in or out of Bell Manor, I'm assuming that we're going to get a very good floor plan before you build anything there, and I'd like to see it.
Well, I would assume that we're going to, if it gets to that point of us wanting to build and restructure that building, we would have to almost certainly have an open, you know, meetings about it and get the public's opinion on it. So. Correct.
Sure. Absolutely.
Of course.
Yes.
It's no indoor swimming pool.
Right. No pools. Thank you, Nancy. Anyone else from the audience? All right. Thank you very much. Moving on to committee reports. None tonight. Resolutions. We have zero. And ordinances. We have 5 minutes to introduce and one with action tonight. Mr. Collier.
Mayor Lauer, before we actually get into the ordinances, we have a procedural matter. We need to suspend the rules of council to add ordinance 16-53 to the agenda.
Mr. Mayor, I move we suspend the rules of council to add ordinance 16-53.
Second by Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Rick Lauer?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybrocker?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Passes 6-0. Ordinance 16-46, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract for the renewal of health insurance.
Council.
I'd like to make a motion for ordinance 1646.
Second.
Was that Mr. Lowry?
Yes.
Okay. And explanation of this ordinance. This is a yearly ordinance we do, and it's an ordinance to allow me to sign off to renew our employees' health insurance. Just in case there's questions that do come up with discussion on council, we only saw a $9.79 per employee increase. The reason the city decided to eat that increase opposed to passing along is simply because how it's dictated in our union contract. If there's a less than 10% increase in the premiums, our employees see no increase, and this is obviously well below a 10% increase. If we see a 10% to 15% in premium cost, the employees pay 20% of the difference. And if anything over 15% increase in premium cost, then our employees pay 25% of the increase. So given that their threshold for the percent of increase did not go over that 10%, the city will have to eat the $9.79 additional. Now that being said, we're actually very lucky to only have a $9.79 increase. A lot of people are getting a way more than that. That's why we're at the situation we're in now. So that is up for your vote.
Thanks, sir. Mr. Reynolds.
I have a quick question. I know it's part of the contract. Mm-hmm. In the future, is it possible for us to start shopping around? Because the reason that it increased was they said here that they didn't project that they would have a higher loss of $7.1 million debt. I feel like that's excessive, and I don't know if there's something we could shop around in the future for
this maybe is last private. Year. Yeah, this 17 and the 18 will be our last year with them. So me and Mr. Harris, our finance director, we're going to have it on our books for about 6 months now, start shopping out. Now, just be very cautious when we do that because we're in a pool with people. So if we go back to, say, McGowan, who I think were with before we entered the pool, we're not going to be in a pool with other people. So we're definitely going to see what the best move is for the city. I'll be honest with you. This whole past 3 years with this, I didn't like it. We didn't know what we were getting. They do these little sneaky terms like deficit recovery. We can't do anything about it because we're in a contract with them.
Yeah.
But there's a yin and yang. Do we pay significantly lower prices because we are in a pool and have to go by their terms? Or do we go on our own outside of the pool so we have our own terms, but we're going to pay a lot more? So we don't know. Once we get their prices out and we start shopping it out, then me and Ms. Harris and we'll probably make the best decision, what's best for the administrative and employees, and then bring it to council for approval.
Sounds fantastic. Yeah, I was just wondering if we start shopping. I know we're locked in,
yeah.
But when it's, like you said, when it says deficit recovery and a $7.1 million debt, just kind of thinking like maybe we should get out.
Sure, understand.
Mr. Carr?
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Pass 6-0.
Mr. Collier, if you wouldn't mind, could we step back just a little bit? We just voted on ordinance 16-53, but I don't think we had
46.
No, 46. We did 46.
We just did
53 is at the end.
We suspended the council.
Oh, okay.
We just
okay.
Had it in front of us. Yeah.
Ordinance 16-48, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 12-5-16. An ordinance amending the estimated resources of the city of New Carlisle to the county auditor that will be available to appropriate for the fiscal year 2016. Ordinance 16-49, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 12-5-16. An ordinance reducing certain appropriations of the City of New Carlisle, Ordinance 1610. Ordinance 16-50, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 12-5-16. An ordinance amending Ordinance 15-54E regarding the return and payment of tax. Ordinance 16-51, introduction tonight, public hearing action on 12-5-16. An ordinance establishing temporary appropriations for fiscal year 2017. Ordinance 16-52, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 12-5-16. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract for the purchase of water softening rock salt. And ordinance 16-53, public hearing in action on 12-5-16. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract with the sheriff of Clark County, Ohio, for police protection within the city limits of New Carlisle, Ohio.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to other business, if anyone was at the last council meeting on November 7th, Councilman Bill McIntyre had resigned from council due to personal reasons and moving out of the city of New Palau, which deemed him non-eligible to have a seat on city council. So that seat is obviously now empty, and the city will move forward with the procedure set in place by our charter to appoint a new member to council. So what we will be doing with that is, and I'll let Gene talk about this a little bit, is we will be running an ad, which I think will be in the New Carlisle Sun starting this week when their paper comes out. And you can pick up applications at the city building, correct, Randy?
Yes.
Thank you.
Right.
To fill those out and return them back to the city. And what we'll do is we will have a meeting and interview all the people who put in applications, and then council will make a motion to appoint one of those to council seat. So I don't know if you had anything you wanted to touch on, specific dates and things of that nature.
You did a pretty good job of it. I'll just cover a few things.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
I just wanted to read shortly from the charter where it talks about filling of vacancies under section 4.07D. Says whenever the office of a council member becomes vacant, council shall provide timely notice of such vacancy through a newspaper or general circulation in the city. There will be a notice of the vacancy in this Wednesday paper, the New Carlisle Sun, 11/23/16. And that notice actually indicates that if you would like to be a council member, you must be a registered voter, and you must also be a resident of the city. As Mayor Lowry had said, council actually, after that publishing, cannot select anyone sooner than 10 days, but we've actually have it set up to where applications will be accepted at the city building until November the 30th, which is a Wednesday, November the 30th, deadline is 4 p.m. on that day. And then once those are received, then council can make the decision as to when they would like to interview candidates. One thing of importance is that if council is unable to fill a vacancy that has happened in the past, then that obligation will, if they don't do that within 30 days, then that falls upon the mayor, who will make the appointment within 7 days. And that's actually occurred twice in this city over the last 20 years. So that's the process. So if you're interested in the council seat, you need to complete an application and at least get it to the city building by November the 30th at 4 p.m.
Also with that, another note, Gene, is for Mr. McIntyre's seat, you would, if, for example, John Smith gets appointed, he will carry out Mr. McIntyre's term for the next, it'd be three more years, right? And then if that person chose to continue to be on council, after that time, they would have to do it like everyone else and run, right.
Yeah, I may not have been real clear. I said New Sun. It'll actually be in the New Carlisle newspaper this week.
Thank you, sir.
I got a question.
About this.
Following in there, it's a couple of days that the city building is going to be closed, isn't it? So is that included in those 10 days?
Where does I know? Yes.
What is the question?
The city building is going to be closed, so they won't be able to,
They can still drop them off. I mean, they can put them in the foyer area. I mean, or they can just bring them back on Monday. I mean, we're closed Thursday and Friday for Thanksgiving.
Right.
But Monday we come back is the 28th, correct? So it'll be that following Wednesday, the 30th. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mr. Reynolds.
I had a quick question. I forgot to bring this up earlier. This is the New Carlisle News. I don't know if we're experiencing the same thing the township is experiencing with volunteer firefighters who are going on runs, if our insurance was kind of haggling with us, kind of like they're doing with the township. I don't know if you've read the New Carlisle News or not. Okay.
Sorry, I know what it's about.
Okay, it's not affecting us? Okay, good deal. Just want to make sure.
Thank you, Mr. Reynolds. Council, any other questions, comments? Moving on to another business, Mr. Collier.
City offices will be closed on Thursday, November the 24th for Thanksgiving, Friday, November the 25th for the day after Thanksgiving. There'll be an intergovernmental meeting here at Smith Park Shelter House next Monday, November the 28th at 6:30. That meeting is open to the public. The Christmas tree parade will be Saturday, December the 3rd, and it'll start at 10 a.m. and starts at...
What's the Christmas tree?
Which one was the typo?
I wonder why it's called the Christmas tree.
Let me start that over with, the Christmas parade.
I might have had a tree lighting ceremony on my mind when I was typing that sentence, sorry.
The Christmas parade will be Saturday, December the 3rd, starts at 10 a.m., and it starts at Madison and Main. And the Christmas tree lighting ceremony will be that same Saturday, December the 3rd at 6 p.m. at Main and East Washington.
Gene, it's a little early for eggnog, man. Thank you, sir. Any other questions or comments from council? Public, any questions? Sarge?
That's okay. Who's taking care of the parade this year?
It'd be Marshall Gorby heads it up with Ron Wright, also from the city.
I'll get a hold of Marshall for the time we need to deputy.
You got his phone number? Okay. All right. Mr. Lowry?
I wish everybody a great Thanksgiving. Don't eat too much and stay safe.
Andy, fried turkey.
All right. And with that being said,
Mr. Mayor, we adjourn.